It's a six-game Monday slate to start the second half of the NHL season. Fresh off a trade, All-Star weekend festivities, and a massive contract extension, Bo Horvat makes his debut with the Islanders. And watch out, because bodies were flying around the Garden as the Flames and Rangers slugged it out in New York City. And the Devils thought they had the edge in the battle of the Hughes brothers, but the Canucks stormed back to take this one down to the wire. We've got all that, and Matthew Tkachuk kept his MVP mojo going. I'm Jamie Hirsch, and On the Fly starts now.
This is Paradise, NHL All-Star, South Florida 2023. There's a buzz in the air. You're going to see the biggest stars.
You're going to just see how talented these guys really are. Don't try to battle with a giant unless you want your head above the mantle in the fire. I get at him, I'm inspired. Why y'all the opposite? You look as sad and tired. The best of the best. There's your winner.
Another beautiful goal.
Happy with an amazing putt.
Oh, what a play.
Boom.
The home fans had a great show, and their guy wins the Cars the MVP. That's a great afternoon of hockey.
What a weekend in South Florida. Matthew Tkachuk had a storybook ending with his four-goal performance, including a hat trick in the semifinal to lead the Atlantic to the championship and eventually win it all. It was the first time the Atlantic won since the 3-on-3 All-Star format began. The Panthers star stole the show all weekend long, much like he's done all season long as the newest member of the Cats. But the fun is over, and it's back to work for Tkachuk and the Panthers, who entered Monday 3 points out of a playoff spot. And to the surprise of no one, Tkachuk wasted no time making an impact for his team against their biggest rival, the Tampa Bay Lightning.
Turned over to Tkachuk. Here's Tkachuk with a centering pass across, save, score.
This is a real smart play by Tkachuk. He'll get in the blind spot of Chernak. On top of that, he makes a nice saucer pass right across to Verhaeghe. Verhaeghe's got that knack about him. He just is calm. He waits in the right areas, and he is scoring goals like crazy.
And it's 1-0 for the home team. Here's Barkov, his shot, and a save by Vasilevsky on a tricky, hard wrister from Alexander Barkov.
He drew that puck from outside in near his feet to gather up some momentum, and he ripped that one into a tough spot for Vasi to save.
Pat Maroon on the clear. He's got Colton up ahead, breaking it and shooting Bobrovsky with a huge save. Sergei Bobrovsky stopping Colton, who got a step on the Panthers' defense.
Colton gets in. Bobrovsky, it's his turn to stand at the top of the crease and make himself look large and make an easy save.
These two goalies putting on a show. Tkachuk has it again behind the net. Waiting, looking, centering, Bennett all alone scores! Tkachuk sets up another one! It's 2-0 Panthers!
Here's Tkachuk, gets his second assist of the game. Look at that beautiful backhander right onto the forehand of Bennett, puts it off the post. And bingo, the Panthers have a 2-0 lead.
Comes back to the line, point swings it across. Sergachev up high, Kucherov scores! Nikita Kucherov with that smooth one-time snapshot beats Bobrovsky and gets the Lightning on the board.
There are times when you think, Cooch, come on, shoot the puck. But what he's really good at, too, is shooting at unsuspecting times, and this is one.
Power play winding down. Verhaeghe will shoot. Knocked down in front, they score! Tkachuk, ka-ching!
And there's Verhaeghe right off the sideboards. He said, okay, I'm going to fire it towards the net. It bounced around. It goes off a Tampa Bay defender. And look at Tkachuk. Just bats it out of the air. Oh, whip it real good, right there in the back of the net.
Montour looking, firing, score, deflected in! And the Panthers open up a 4-1 lead on Tampa Bay.
Three-card Monty, again, the Panthers with the forecheck, and they're able to separate the Lightning from the puck. Watch the stick out in front. Goes right off the blade, and puck goes straight down and bounces through Vasilevskiy. To get Vasilevskiy to give that puck away. Oh, behind the net. Whoops. And there's that long reach by the veteran, Eric Staal.
Tkachuk has it again. Moving in. The feed, the shot. They got another one. Matthew Tkachuk and Carter Verhaeghe are blowing the Lightning out of the building. It's 6-1.
Another goal for Carter Verhaeghe. But look at the patience for Tkachuk. He draws a defender, makes sure that Verhaeghe had a clear shooting lane on the far side, and then he puts it right between the legs of Vasilevskiy.
He's just incredible in front, Matthew Tkachuk. Here he is, deflected home! Tkachuk, ka-ching! 2 goals and 5 points for Matthew Tkachuk. It's 7-1 Panthers.
Wow. Well, after a successful weekend hosting the All-Star Game, the Panthers came up big against their in-state division rivals. The line of Carter Verhaeghe, Sam Bennett, and All-Star Game MVP Matthew Tkachuk combined for 12 points in this one, and Tkachuk led the way with 5. Congrats to Paul Maurice, too, who became the 6th coach in NHL history to reach 800 career wins after this statement victory. Afterward, Matthew Tkachuk was very happy with this performance.
Well, we played hard, and not going to lie, that one felt really good to beat those guys. So hopefully we can continue it here these last 30 and give us a good push and some momentum and make a deep run here.
Speaking of making a deep run, what does a win like this say about this group as you look to make a push for the playoffs?
Well, we started off strong coming off the break and coming back here, and the energy was awesome here. Our fans are awesome, and it was just a great atmosphere to get this win.
For you personally, it's been a very busy week. 48 hours ago, you won the NHL All-Star MVP honor. Tonight, you have a 5-point night. What is it that just keeps you going?
I don't know, just playing here in front of these guys. It's super fun, and I'm loving every minute of it.
And lastly, when you did win the MVP honor, you won a car. The fans want to know, what are you doing with the car?
I gave it to my grandma right after the game, so she was crying. It worked out great.
A very lucky grandma. Matthew, thanks so much.
Yep, thank you.
What a guy. Well, what a last few days it's been for Matthew Tkachuk, All-Star Game MVP, first star of the week, and now a 5-point night against the Bolts. He became the 4th player to rack up at least 4 points in their first game following the All-Star break, joining Mario Lemieux, Ray Bourque, and Mike Bossy. Maybe you've heard of him.
There's just a whole bunch of uncertainty out there in Vancouver right now. What's going to happen with Bo Horvat?
Vancouver has shown no inclination to let anyone talk to Horvat.
And this is news. The New York Islanders have acquired Bo Horvat from the Vancouver Canucks.
This is exactly what they needed. As I say, Bo Scorvat, the way he's played this year, because he's scoring all the time.
The trade is done.
I'm not going to lie, it hasn't sunk in yet, but I think it looks good on me. I couldn't be more thrilled and excited to be part of the New York Islanders. I can't wait to start playing games and meeting the guys.
Bo Horvat making his debut with the Islanders tonight. Fresh off of signing an 8-year contract extension.
Well, all I can tell you is it's too long and it's too much money.
Everybody's been so welcome. I feel right at home here. So to be locked in here for a year is special to me, especially to my family. And we can't wait to get everybody here.
Believe it or not, it's only been 1 week since Lou Lamoriello got the trade market moving by sending 2 players and a pick to Vancouver for Bo Horvat. That was last Monday when Horvat was on his bi-week vacation at Disney World with his family. A few days later, he went to Florida, where he sported an Islanders logo while still playing as an all-star on the Pacific team since he was selected as a member of the Canucks. That was Saturday, and on Sunday, the Isles signed him to a hefty 8-year, $68 million extension without him even playing a single game for New York. So finally, on Monday, he took the ice for his first NHL game with a team not named the Canucks, making his Islanders debut against the Flyers. Let's check him out.
Bo Horvat wearing number 14. Tonight he plays his first game with a team that he's already signed an 8-year extension to stay with here on Long Island. Well, underway, and he starts his Islanders tenure with a face-off win. Horvat off the ice. Nelson comes on. Mayfield has it. Slides in and across, and Nelson couldn't get it home. Hart scrambling out of his net. It banked in. That crossed the goal line, did it not?
This is taken.
look. Does it get over the... No, it does not. Right on the goal line as Provorov is able to save it with the quick stick.
Horvat there working on Cam York. York up the boards. Bailey beat him there. Barzal from the goal line. Got it to Horvat and a save made along the way. I'm not sure how much he saw it, but he stopped it with a blocker.
What a pass that was by Barzal. Able to put it right on the stick, and Horvat had a really good look, and Hart comes up with a big save. But those three guys, as I said, talking about chemistry, well, let's take another look at it. Let's go to the replay. Horvat's going, Barzy, get out of the way.
Harry's ahead now for Josh Bailey. Bailey in the slot, plays it over. Palmieri shoots, scores! Kyle Palmieri on the power play.
Yes, people, the news is here. It isn't exactly who you thought might score that first power play goal. Razzmadazzle and Josh Bailey runs a beautiful pass all the way over to the forehand of Kyle Palmieri, and he goes right into the toy department off the post, and the Islanders have what they need, a power play goal and a lead. Not easy when you're under duress, but Barzal doing his thing, creating time and space.
Nelson in front, Dobson, Barzal scores!
Man alive, was that a terrific play. Islanders did a great job just to control the puck in the corner. They fought for it. A beautiful pass out from the corner, and the Islanders go to work down low. I mean, look at that. Get it on the corner, win the one-on-one battles. So there's all three forwards. I like that. An aggressive forward move. And Barzal gets on the positive side. What a pass that was. I believe that was Brock Nelson.
Well, Matt Barzal with goals in back-to-back games.
Sealer into the front. Sealer takes it around behind the net. Takes it out of his skates. Comes for some help. Now he's got it again. Gets it to DeAngelo. Little wrister. Score! DeLaurier may have deflected that. Brown was there as well. Flyers cut the deficit in half. It's 2-1.
And Sealer aggressively took the puck all the way down the wall. Well, what an outstanding job by the Flyers getting in on the forecheck. DeLaurier looks like he gets a piece of it. And a heads-up play by Tony D. There's the stick of DeLaurier that knocks it down. A skillful tip. And the Flyers get that one right back.
The Flyers can't get out of each other's way there. Now Konechny does. He'll burrow in after it. Konechny back across. Provorov. Now it bounces to Konechny back in. It's a rebound rattling around. But it did not go.
Just 38 seconds to go in the period. A flurry of chances for the Philadelphia Flyers.
Hectic hockey out there. Coaches are on their toes. They're just trying to get a little bit too much done. Look at the front of the net. Everybody is scrambling all over the place. That one almost bounces in.
The Islanders managing to hang on to that one goal lead as John Tortorella uses his timeout.
And come up with something in the final 60 seconds here. One more push for the Flyers.
10 seconds left. One last chance for the Flyers. They tip this one in deep with six. Mayfield gets to it. He's able to pin it to the corner. 2 seconds and one. And the Islanders come into Philadelphia, pick up a 2-1 victory in their first game out of the All-Star.
Yeah, that was an important one for the Islanders. You make a big trade, Brendan. You know it's going to help you. And when you win the game, it's just a little more proof in the pudding.
So the Isles welcome Bo Horvat to the team with their third straight win. He finished the night with 4 shots in just over 19 minutes of ice time in his Isles debut. And Semyon Varlamov has won back-to-back starts while allowing just one goal in each game. Here's Horvat on his first game as a member of the Islanders.
Caught myself out there a little too long sometimes, running on adrenaline there in the first period, and then I was overall happy with the game. Obviously it feels even better to get that win. I'm not gonna lie, I was really nervous tonight, and the guys made me feel really comfortable, and they were great, and obviously it feels even better to get that win and get my legs under me, and hopefully feel even better here tomorrow.
I mean, he makes a huge impact. You saw it day one. He's in there, and he's a great player. He's gonna make an impact every night, so we're really happy to have him, and hopefully he just continues to get comfortable and keep providing a spark for us.
Well, after dropping 11 of their first 13 games to start 2023, the Isles have now racked up 3 straight wins for the first time since late December. Looking at their last 10 games, the biggest change has been on the defensive side. They've allowed just 2 goals during this 3-game win streak. Coming up, anytime a Devils goalie is mentioned in the same breath as Marty Brodeur, they must be doing something right. Find out if Vitek Vanacek could join a very exclusive club next. Welcome back to On the Fly. Let's get out to MSG for a wild one between the Flames and Rangers.
Off the board, Tatum moves in with Lafreniere. Great shot by Filippino. Rangers lead 1-0.
He picked up right where he left off, Joe.
And Lyon's been the best line on the ice so far. It's early, but they've been good. A lot of jump.
Here's Mangiapane onto the puck as he works it in on the backhand. Tries to drive the net, force wide. Loose puck. Coleman jabs at it. Palacios scores! Coleman and Mangiapane right there whacking away. And the Flames able to tie this game. Oh, clean old pass hit by Truba. Truba with a clean hit, and he's challenged with a fight by Tannen. 2-on-1, he moves in with Miller-Rack. Pass it across, save Halak. Oh, big save as he dropped Dubé.
Took a swipe at it, just couldn't get the blade of his stick on the puck.
Lucic gets knocked down. Fans like that for the penalty upcoming.
Sammy Blais. And here comes Lucic.
Zadorov goes after Sammy Blais.
Weegar
and Cooley going at it. Sammy Blais and Zadorov. The helmets have come off. Patrick's pass taken away. Breaking down his heel. Hedo drives to the net. Hedo scores! How about Filippino? That's two. Oh, man. He's shooting it. He's feeling it. A switch spots with the Foley. Gives her the puck to Foley. Shoots! Scores! Have tied it up at two.
Well, it's that same spot, isn't it, Rick?
He loves it.
He loves it, and he's good at it.
Patrick against Truba. Oh! Oh! Big hit! And once again, Truba's challenge, this time by Dubé.
And Dylan Dubé steps up a couple of weight classes to defend his teammate.
Oh, man. Side of the net.
Sutherland right there, along with the other referee, Brandon Schrader, to make the call. And for the time being, Flames tied this up at three.
And who else but Noah Hanifin?
Right on cue.
Right on cue, right?
After video review with the situation room, it was determined that the puck was deflected in. It was not kicking, no kicking motion. We have a good goal.
So Giacchini's goal will count. Coleman on it. Now Backlund in. Mangiapane goes in front. Here's Stone. Scores! Michael Stone! With that slap shot, rips it home. And the Flames have their first lead of the hockey game.
That's why Gerard Gallant saying, hey, what's going on here?
Pass in front. Score! Mika Zibanejad! Off the feed from Artemi Panarin. And the Rangers tie it at four. Zadorov gets back. Lafreniere.
One of the spiciest games of the season at Madison Square Garden. There were 62 combined penalty minutes between these two teams, and Alexi Lafreniere got the last word with his Energizer OT winner. Mika Zibanejad led the Blue Shirts with 3 points, including the primary helper on the OT winner. Artemi Panarin chipped in with 2 helpers to become the first Ranger with 40 assists in each of his first 4 seasons with the team. Here's Zibanejad on his team preparing for a postseason push.
Try to prepare as much as you can. Try to figure out what's the right way and how do you manage the break? How do you take advantage of the break, knowing that we have a lot of games and not a whole lot of days left here, coming up with a big stretch and pushing for the playoffs. But I thought this was good. Sloppy at times, but overall I thought it was a great effort, and we wanted it.
Getting a game winner in OT is always fun, and it was a hard slap shot, so I thought it was going in, and then I see it coming back in front. I was kind of behind the net a little bit, and I just put on the brakes and sprint to it and try to score.
No breaks. We're going to stop Filipino's momentum in Monday's win. He extended his goal streak to 4 games with his 2-goal night against the Flames. And since early January, Filipino ranks among the top 5 in goal scoring amongst all NHLers, trailing Sebastian Aho, David Pastrnak, and Jack Hughes.
No one makes a bigger transformation than Vitek Vanacek. The absolute battler guys out there on the ice.
Competitor, no question about it.
And Vanacek says no.
Oh, boy.
9 consecutive wins. That's not enough.
Really proud of the Vitek.
It didn't go.
Look at the athleticism and desperation from Vitek Vanacek.
Even when he's struggling a bit and he's scrambling, you know that he's going to reset his mind, and that's what the Devils thrive off of.
The people is great here. The team is good. You know, I'm so happy. I can't say anything else. It's really nice.
No doubt about it. Vitek Vanacek has been the biggest reason why the Devils have made one of the biggest single-season turnarounds in recent memory and are suddenly a legit playoff team. He entered Monday on a personal 9-game win streak and would try to become the first Devils goalie to win 10 in a row since Marty Brodeur in 05-06. Then there's Jack Hughes, fresh off playing in his second straight All-Star game and looking to continue his tear against his older brother Quinn and the Vancouver Canucks. Off to New Jersey.
Any way you look at this game tonight, the numbers, well, they don't look good for the Vancouver Canucks. Jack Hughes is coming off Player of the Month honors. Vitek Vanacek has won 9 consecutive starts, major test for the Canucks, who will be debuting Beauvillier, who's wearing number 72.
Curtis Lazar in some pain at the Vancouver bench. He went off slowly his last shift. He's being checked out. His commits. Kuzmenko dances in, and what a goal. Andre Kuzmenko just undressed his check and put one in on the forehand to give the Canucks a 1-0 lead.
A little touch along by Fabian Zetterlund, and Jack Hughes has some space again. Hughes trying to cut inside. He was knocked away by Tyler Myers. Graves uncorks the blast. Delia made the save. He spilled a rebound, and it trickles behind goal.
You see Jack Hughes with that tremendous burst of speed through the neutral zone. Everybody, you see the forwards want to get to Jack Hughes. They got 3 guys on him. Eventually, he loses the puck or it's poked away. Jack Hughes draws so much attention to him.
Zetterlund chipped it forward. Hughes is in, and Hughes scores!
The All-Star break by Jack Hughes, and again he's just been flying in the first.
Kuzmenko plays it off the boards, and here's a breakaway the other way to Elias Pettersson in, and Pettersson hits the post
in between, and Pettersson wicked wrister and rips it off the pipe. This has been a fast-paced game, some bouncing pucks, helter-skelter all over. Just a quick wrist shot, head up all the way, and look at this terrific redirection from way out.
So the Devils lead for the first time tonight. Here's Jesper Bratt looking for more. Heischer, a one-timer, and Delia got a piece of it. Heischer gets it again. Delia the save. Pallott puts it on. He scores! Andre Pallott with his second goal of the shift, and the Devils are up 2. And now Zetterlund's got it. Devils looking for more. Hughes open.
Explosion.
Garland feeds back. Now here's Shen with a shot. Scores! Sheldon Dries was in front as Luke Shen let rip from the right point.
I think that went straight in.
And I think it is Luke Shen's goal. Here's Riley Stillman at the other end. They score! Curtis Lazar finally has his second goal of the year. And the Canucks, after surrendering 3 quickly, I've gotten a couple back, and it's a 1-goal game again. DiGiuseppe in with drives, 2-on-1. Phil DiGiuseppe shoots, scores! First goal in 710 days in the NHL. And Phil DiGiuseppe on an Adman rush has tied the game at 4.
The final couple of seconds ticking away. 4-4 Devils and Canucks. To overtime we go for the fifth time in six games. Beauvillier the other way. Beauvillier ripped it high. And Jack Hughes is all alone. Hughes coming in for the win. His brother chased him down. And Delia makes the save.
Oh, my.
And for the third time in the last couple of weeks, the Devils will get a 4-on-3 in overtime. Hughes, Brad, what time to score? The Devils do it again in overtime. Jesper Bratt with the game winner. And this will actually count as their league-leading 17th come-from-behind win as they were down 1-0 at one point.
Huge win, huge 2 points. The resiliency of this team continues.
That's a game-winning overtime goal powered by Energizer for Jesper Bratt. Wasn't the strongest nights from Vanecek, but he does get it done to become the first Devils goalie to win 10 straight since Marty Brodeur in 2005-2006. And with 3 points, Jack Hughes has 5 straight multi-point outings that sets a new career high. Here's more from Bratt on a big win.
You know, we just have that good mentality in the room. We're never satisfied. We're never happy. And we're never letting off the gas until the clock rings. So we're always ready. We know we can do it. We've been battling from behind a couple times, and these kind of chances going into overtime, we know those points are going to make a huge difference. So it's good to walk away with a win.
3 goals in 50 seconds obviously was the difference, a 5-on-3 and a 4-on-3. Other than that, I liked our effort. Bad things can happen sometimes. Things don't go your way. 3 goals in 50 seconds, you need somebody to kind of settle things down with a, you know, whether it's a good hit or something inside. So we'll develop those guys, and I got to evaluate some other guys. But yeah, for the most part, like I said, I thought we held our own.
What a night it was for Hughes and the Devils. Hughes had 2 goals and a helper on the OT winner to put him at 67 points through 50 games this season. Now, there have been plenty of young generational talents who have come up over the last 20 years, and Jack is very much up there amongst the best of them on this list. And former Devil PK Subban will be honored in Nashville next Monday night before and during the team's game against the Coyotes. As we continue to celebrate Black History Month, let's take a look at Subban's stellar career, including his 3 appearances at the NHL All-Star Game.
He's always fired up to be here. That's what I love about PK. He just wears it on his sleeve. He loves playing this game.
PK Subban coming on. I think he's doing his best Yager impersonation. Leave it to PK to get creative again. I got to get the salute.
Back for Subban, and he scores!
You talk about skill, though. Look at this one. Give, go, get it back, and finish it.
The Central Division captain is PK Subban. Certainly a fan favorite. No surprise there. I don't think there's anybody that's doing more off the ice. He's just a fantastic guy.
This event is tailored for a guy like that.
It's like anybody else. When I leave my house, I like to look my best.
He's always having fun.
PK is such a personality.
He scores!
Star, and he's got a big goal.
PK Subban, and he still gets goal.
Finds himself all alone as he jumps into the bench, trying to get his troops excited.
He's leading by example. That's what captains are supposed to do.
And in addition to plenty of memorable moments in his 3 All-Star game appearances, PK Subban had an accomplished career over 13 seasons with the Canadiens, Predators, and Devils. 467 points over 834 career games, highlighted, of course, by a Norris Trophy in 2012-13, a Stanley Cup Final appearance with the Preds in 2017, and the King Clancy Memorial Trophy in 2021-22. Well, it's no surprise Stars legend Mike Modano holds the franchise record for most games played, but after Monday, he has some company in the 1,000 Games Club as Jamie Benn celebrated a major milestone. That's next.
Hughes, Brad, what time to score! The Devils do it again in overtime! Jesper Bratt with the game winner!
They finish it off with some brilliance on the one-time blast from Jesper Bratt.
Nelson in front, Thompson, Barzal scores! Thompson coming down the lane, looked off the shot and put it on the stick of Matt Barzal.
Man alive, we got a terrific play.
Well, Matt Barzal with goals in back-to-back games. Lafreniere scores! The game winner, Alexi Lafreniere!
I mean, that was a great save by Markstrom. Lafreniere doesn't forget about the play.
The shot, they got another one! Matthew Tkachuk
this line has been on fire.
The Panthers came out of the All-Star break with a bang, pouncing on the Lightning with a 7-1 win. It was a historic win for head coach Paul Maurice, who became the sixth coach in NHL history to reach the 800 win mark. And speaking of milestones, let's head to Dallas on a milestone night for Jamie Benn.
Tonight, more than 13 years later, so many signature moments along the way. He skates in game 1,000. He becomes the first man in Stars history to play the first 1,000 games of his career entirely with Dallas. Away from two ducks, Marchman joins in. And Foxy comes away with possession. Backdoor feed, Lundqvist scores! Tremendous work from Radek Foxa. Nils Lundqvist, the finish. Stars on the board first. John Klingberg back here in American Airlines Center. First time as a visitor. Honored during the break with a tribute video, a thumbs up, a tap of the heart, a salute to the crowd. And he got quite the deserved ovation here at American Airlines Center. For Zegras and the Ducks. Hit the brakes on the left wing hash marks. Flips a backhand. Shenkirk blocked. Marchman, then a chance. Side of the net for Henrique. Up and over the cage.
That missed by a considerable margin on a wobbly puck for Adam Henrique, who has done some goal scoring for them of late.
Loose puck claimed by Henrique, then turned over Gurianov, and the Stars will spread it out. Gurianov backdoor hit, scores! And the Stars have doubled their lead.
He was hard on the puck down in the corner in support. The puck jacks Henrique, gets the puck right back again, and nice work by Rope Hint. I don't know how he did that.
Moves it for Klingberg. Tough play for him. Stars take it away. It's Sagan. Backdoor feed. What a stop. Gibson rebound loose for a moment. Foxa had the second chance, but Marchment the first look, and somehow Gibson keeps this game at 2-0.
Oh, this is fantastic.
Nice little pass to Comtois. Across the top. Shattenkirk shot. Score! Kevin Shattenkirk. I believe that may have been tipped in front. Silverberg was there.
Yeah, I think Jakob Silverberg gets a stick on this. And Silverberg gets a little touch on it, knocks it downward and into the back of the net. That's a huge goal.
Good keep in the line by Zegras. Zegras into the slot. Henrique, score! The Ducks have tied it.
Keep a puck in at the blue line because of second effort, and that allows Anaheim an outnumbered attack. They haven't had many of them in this game, but boy, the execution is real good as Trevor Zegras finds Adam Henrique right in the middle of the ice.
50 seconds left in the Ben High sticking penalty. Cut off by Lindell. He'll push it forward. 2-on-1 shorthanded. Lindell to Glendening. Glendening, Lindell. Save! Gibson got over to his right.
What a sweet feed by Glendening to Esa Lindell.
So here's Jason Robertson, an assist in the game. Among the leaders in NHL scoring. First shooter, and he takes his time on Gibson. Robertson upstairs. He scores. Gorgeous. An Ottinger save equals a Stars win. Henrique is the man with the puck. Henrique lost the handle. Ottinger holds, and the Stars come out of the All-Star break. And for tonight, they leave their OT struggles behind them.
The Stars hang on in the shootout in Jamie Benn's milestone night to extend their lead to 3 points over the Jets atop the Central. John Klingberg had 2 shots on goal in his return to Dallas, and Adam Henrique now has 7 goals in his last 9 games. Afterward, Benn reflected on reaching the 1,000-game mark.
It turned me into the man that I am today. Came here as a young kid and had a great support cast right from day one, and got to grow up here in Dallas, and it's been a great honor. I thought what the guys did was pretty funny. I'm fortunate enough to have my family here and fiance, and it was just overall great night, and finish it off with 2 big points.
It's been quite the renaissance for Jamie Benn, who added to his list of milestones on Monday. Back in December, he recorded his 800th career point and then moved into second place on the franchise goals list less than a week later. Now he has 1,000 NHL games under his belt, all with Dallas. Let's head out now to the desert for the Wild and Coyotes.
tightly called hockey game so far through the first period of play.
A shift of almost 3 minutes for Matt Zuccarello ends in a perfect feed to Kirill Kaprizov, and Minnesota's on the board first.
Well, the vision and the passing are there. That was evident in the first period. But this line uses the entire zone, and I mean the entire zone, that whole shift.
One penalty coming up here. The Wild are going to be short. Caddies with three shots in their first three power plays.
Hit down high. Chikrin scores! Jacob Chikrin is tied it at one. That's one of the hardest. Did we get a mile per hour on that? That was an absolute laser. An absolute missile by Jacob Chikrin.
Stick save from Vemelka there. Turnover.
And they score.
What a gift from the Coyotes.
Comes out high. Brown unloads. And that shot over the top.
Oh, what a shot here. No such thing as a bad shot. That thing's coming in high and hard.
Wow. Back to the line, Valimaki. Across.
Chikrin scores! Jacob Chikrin! Second of the night, and he's tied it at two! Oh, my!
Beautifully executed play all the way around. Starts at the faceoff. They bring it down. They bring it across. Chikrin had an opportunity in that first period from a Clayton Keller pass. He's not going to miss this one. He keeps it low. He wants it right over that pad of Marc-Andre Fleury.
But Fisher will look to poke it out, and here they come.
Jack McBain racing back. McBain is in. McBain, he scores. Jack McBain.
And what a turn of events. The Coyotes with a massive kill. And here's the play right there, the poke. And McBain off to the races.
Boldy with it. Zuccarello across. Kaprizov to the front.
It's bouncing around and it's underneath and they can't get it past Veggie.
How did that stay out? My goodness, Kirill Vemelka.
Wow, the Yotes hand the Wild their fourth straight road loss. Jacob Chikrin scored two of the three Arizona goals and now has 7 goals in 11 career home games against the Wild. Kirill Vemelka was solid throughout, making 33 saves in the victory. Well, Patrick Kane may be the biggest fish on the market, but David Pagnotta breaks down the whole trade landscape and who else could be on the move as we inch closer to the deadline. Stay tuned for more On the Fly.
We got some trade news for you. The Minnesota Wild acquired Ryan Reeves from the Rangers.
This was a really big one today. Reeves has played in big playoffs games. He's gone to cup final. He knows what it takes.
He knows he's a physical guy. He's got to bring energy. He's a great locker room guy, so I think it's a nice pickup.
And Reeves goes on the offensive with a flurry of runs.
And you see Ryan Reeves saying, boys, let's go, let's go.
With the trade deadline right around the corner, Bo Horvat's on the move. Wow, he has been Mr. Everything for the Vancouver Canucks. He's the kind of guy who can just help anywhere in your lineup. That's a big add for the New York Islanders.
Can't wait to start over and get to Long Island and get things going here. It's a good team, and here to make a playoff push.
So the All-Star break is behind us, and it is officially trade deadline season. Bo Horvat was the first big domino to fall before March 3rd, joining the Islanders and immediately signing an 8-year, $68 million contract extension. With more on how that deal could affect a future contract for one of these top free agents and other rumblings around the NHL, here's David Pagnotta on NHL Tonight.
We know that the last offer that was presented to Dylan Larkin's camp wasn't received overly well. He's looking for a long-term deal, that 8-year extension, and I believe the number starts with a 9, as in $9 million. It could be just above that on an AAV, but he's looking for that type, those types of dollars, and I believe that message was relayed prior to Horvat signing his new contract with the New York Islanders. So if you're looking and trying to compare the two, and you're looking to see from an overall perspective, not just this season, as you see the numbers here. I mean, Horvat's having a heck of a year. But what Dylan Larkin brings to the table with Horvat off the market from a free agent perspective, it changes the dynamic of that negotiation a little bit. So I've got to wonder or imagine that the starting point from their side has to be 8.5, which is something that I'm sure Detroit's not overly pleased with. But it is, I mean, that's the nature of the beast here as he tries to get that $9 million plus a year.
Could be talking 8 years, $70 million. Who knows? Massive money there. Well, the Canucks, yeah. They opened the floodgates of that Horvat trade last week. Where do we go from here now for them?
Yeah, well, everybody certainly wants to see who they're going to potentially move out next. And you had some guys on that board with Luke Shannon, of course, Brock Besser, excuse me. Now, there is belief, especially over the weekend, I was told that trade talks have picked up with respect to Brock Besser and some of the other teams that are interested in him. He's got two more years left on his contract, $6.65 million cap hit. So there is term there. But the dollars, based on his performance, not only this season but last as well, have been somewhat concerning to a few teams, which could result in either the Vancouver Canucks retaining money on Besser's contract, or they're going to have to take a body back as part of that deal. He's not the only one. As you see up there, you have Tyler Myers, Connor Garland, Luke Shen that we discussed. These are all players that are being discussed right now. And everyone, again, is trying to see who could be one of the next guys that are going to leave. But things have definitely picked up on Besser's front. And my understanding is they would prefer, Vancouver would, to get something done well ahead of the trade deadline. We've got 25 more days to figure that out.
Yeah, with respect to Pavilion, I still thought they could have got more in that trade. But, again, it remains to be seen what Vancouver's going to be doing. Max Pacioretty going back on LTIR gives the Hurricanes some open cap space. How does Don Waddell plan to use that flexibility as the deadline approaches?
Yeah, it changes the dynamic, Adnan, for that team, because now all of a sudden you've got that extra $7 million to play with of LTIR space that you can go out there and potentially use ahead of the deadline. They are looking, and they have been linked to a few players before, Ryan O'Reilly, Jonathan Toews even to a certain extent, trying to see what's going on there. Do they go on the wing and try to get that offensive guy to add to this group with a Vladimir Tarasenko? The fact that they now have that additional money to play with from a cap perspective, that could mean the world to a lot of teams. Vegas as well with their situation with Mark Stone. But from Carolina's side of things, you know, the last few years people have wondered, would they spend the money? The money's not the issue for the Hurricanes. It comes down to what price are they willing to pay from a cost package perspective. I hear they don't want to give up too much futures on a rental piece, but now this extra cap space might allow them to go all in as they'd like to. And sometimes you got to decide if the juice is worth the squeeze.
Yeah. Look at the way heat. For me, the action is the juice. I'm in. Reports came out today. Patrick Kane has been discussing trade options with his agent. What more can you tell me about that?
Yeah, well, this was anticipated that around the end of January, beginning of February, that both Patrick Kane and Jonathan Toews would begin discussions with the Chicago Blackhawks over what their options could potentially be if they are being moved. Now, Patrick Kane talking today, saying that he's spoken with Pat Brisson, his agent, and has been presented with a few options of teams that could have interest in acquiring him or trading for him, rather, before the trade deadline. Now, he also reiterated he's not in any position right now to make a decision that will likely come at the end of this month or just prior to that March 3rd deadline. But he is catching wind of the teams that are interested in him, and that could help his process. Whether it's the New York Rangers, the Dallas Stars, or some of the other teams that have interest in Patrick Kane, he's well aware of it now. And it's going to take these next few weeks to ultimately decide where he wants to go if he is willing to move that no movement clause and go to a new team. He said it's exciting. The opportunity is exciting. He's just got to make sure he's comfortable with the right decision.
Always good insight from David Pagnotta, keeping the Florida theme going with that shirt. Last thing, what'd you think of the splash tank? Would you do that? Come on.
I'd be all in. Yeah, I would definitely be part of that. I'm curious how they're going to make that work in Toronto if they do expand that going into next season. Maybe break through a light sheet of ice, but it was entertaining. I liked it.
Yeah, we thought it was pretty cool, too. Well, the NHL announced an all-star edition of their three stars of the weekend. No surprise, it is a bit heavy on the Atlantic Division. Third star Mitch Marner had 6 assists, and second star Dylan Larkin had 5 goals and 1 assist across their 2 games on Saturday. The first star, again, no surprise, is the hometown kid, or for the hometown team, Matthew Tkachuk, who compiled 4 goals and 3 assists on his way to winning the all-star MVP award. And that brings us now to your top shelf plays of the night.
Center save. Great save by Halak. Oh, man, he robbed Mangiapane. But Chuck has it again. Moving in. The feed, the shot. They got it.
Shoot. Knocked down in front, they score! Tkachuk, ka-ching! The hands are incredible.
And
And look at Tkachuk, just bats it out of the air. Oh, whip it real good right there in the back of the net.
Sidney Crosby taking on his boy, Nathan MacKinnon.
These two from Cole Harbour, Nova Scotia.
Yeah, he's one of my closest friends.
These guys know when they're on the ice against each other.
There's very few guys who can dominate a game. He's one of them.
Back home in Cole Harbour, a couple of Stanley Cup parties.
I have my name engraved on the cup with 87, my idol.
Nathan MacKinnon and Sidney Crosby will make their hometown of Cole Harbour, Nova Scotia, very proud when they go head-to-head on Tuesday as part of a six-game slate around the NHL. MacKinnon and the defending cup champs will look to continue their recent surge and try to jump the Flames for that second wildcard spot. For a preview of Tuesday's matchup in Pittsburgh, let's check in with our NHL Tonight crew.
All right, thanks very much. It's tough to think you're underrated when you're an all-star, and yet that's the case right now for Mikko Rantanen. This guy's got 10 goals his last 13 games, 199 in his career, and he's still the most underrated players in hockey, Perry.
He's the Western Conference Nikita Kucherov. This poor guy, it doesn't matter what he does. It's all Nathan MacKinnon. It's all these guys in front of him. All Mikko Rantanen does is his job. He just goes out there and scores goals. He is a premier goal scorer, one of the best in this league, and he is not going to stop for anyone regardless.
Avalanche, by the way, hot entering the break, 7-1 record, averaging 4 goals per game. And this gives me a lot of fun, Thomas, because it's a Cole Harbour showdown. Cole Harbour, Nova Scotia. Small place here in the Maritimes, but you've got Crosby and MacKinnon going head-to-head.
Yeah, they know how to breed them out there because these guys are they're the two most competitive guys, right? And I think we all watch them, and you see how good they are. You see the Stanley Cups. You see the trophies and the goals and the points and the skill. But what you don't see all the time is the competitiveness. And I've talked to so many guys that say it's a treat to watch these guys skate in the summer with one another because they're so competitive. You would think it's a Stanley Cup final, but you're going to see it in person. And I think they bring the best out of each other. There's a little extra competition for them, not only to win the game, but to be the better one of those two Nova Scotia guys. So always fun when these guys meet.
Yeah, to that point, Sid has 5 goals his last 5 games against the Avalanche. So he does pick it up against Colorado. And currently tied with Stan Mikita, 32nd all-time, 541 goals. Amazing what Crosby's doing even this late in his career. Avalanche and Penguins, we look forward to it. Back to you.
Thanks, guys. It's time for your 3 stars of the night. Our 3rd star goes to Jack Hughes, who added 2 goals and added a primary assist on Jesper Bratt's OT winner. Hughes has 18 points during his career-high 9-game point streak. Mika Zibanejad gets your 2nd star of the night. Just like Hughes, he had 2 goals and had the primary helper on the overtime winner. Zibanejad finished the night with a game-high 8 shots on goal. And your 1st star of the night belongs to Matthew Tkachuk. Following up on his MVP performance at the All-Star Game, Tkachuk put up 2 goals and 3 assists for his 3rd 5-point night of his career.
It's time for Jamie's Herschelian Feat of the Night.
Yeah, this one happened over the weekend, but it's as good a save as we've seen all season, and it happened in the ECHL. Check out Rylan Peranto of the Fort Wayne Comets with this incredible stop. He had to go all the way across the crease, kicking his legs up behind his head before just barely getting his stick on it to keep this puck out of the net. Wow, that is a stop. The Comets went on to win 5-2, but that save will be remembered for quite a long time. Thanks so much for watching On the Fly. I'm Jamie Hirsch. Here's the best from Monday.
We'll hold out is here. My team can make the playoffs.
And the Islanders come into Philadelphia, pick up a 2-1 victory.
Jamie Benn has skated in 1,000 games in the National Hockey League.
Look for you. Score!